Yeah, what's up? Snowman? What are you talking about? Me neither. Strange, but not strange enough for me to care. Hello, YouTube, and Merry Christmas Eve! So today, we'll be looking at something that's very fitting of this time of year. A horror movie. Naturally. Although, to be fair, this is a Christmas horror movie, and it's not even a complete horror movie, it's also a horror comedy. So, without further ado, let's get into Krampus. So the story is fairly easy to follow. A dysfunctional family gets together to celebrate Christmas, and of course problems ensue. And eventually one of them, Max, gets really peeved at all the rest and runs up to his room and tears up his letter to Santa and throws it out his window. This is what summons Krampus. For some reason. Yeah, I don't really know why exactly tearing up his letter to Santa summoned Krampus. I mean, like, wouldn't it already be the unfestive spirit of the whole entire family that would have summoned him? I mean, wouldn't Max have just running up to his room and even thinking about ripping up his letter to Santa summon him, not actually doing it? But yeah, anyway, so for some odd reason that summons him. Now, I mean, okay, yeah, I guess it could make some sense since we see later on when the grandma gives her story about her experience with Krampus. And she says that when she was younger, she threw a bear into a fire, and that's kind of what brought him there that night. So, I assume that that's what does it. Like, if you destroy something that's more seasonal and more Christmas related, and if you do that around Christmas, then yeah, that's pretty much the ultimate sign that you've given up on the holiday, and well, yep, that just means that you're all ready to die. So, yeah. I guess that that's just how Krampus sees it. I don't know. But yeah, that's really all I can get for why I waited for a little bit. And also, the whole family has not lost the spirit of Christmas. I mean, just because one kid lost it doesn't mean everyone did. The grandma is still completely festive for reasons that I'll get into later, which I kind of already brought up. But yeah, still, she's still very festive and still trying to do her best to keep the family together. So, yeah. Why does this still count? And also, Max's dad, Tom, came upstairs just a little bit ago and got him actually feeling a whole lot better and more in the spirit of Christmas. What exactly changed there? I really want to know. Like, in the few seconds, he's just like, yeah, you know, maybe I will send my letter to Santa. Never mind, rip, throw out the window. Like, why? Why? What changed there with him? But yeah, anyway, so he ripped up his letter to Santa, threw it out the window, and Krampus is summoned. If I already say Christmas, I'm sorry. But yeah, Krampus is summoned, and well, he starts killing off the family and everyone else in the town one by one. Yeah, why are you killing everyone else in the town? What did they do? How are they related to this at all? You're targeting this one family. Why go after the rest? Just have them stuck around the very perimeter of their house. Why not just do that? Why kill everybody else? There's some random guy who was gonna go home and spend Christmas with his family after he finished delivering a package, and he died. Why did he deserve to die? He was still festive. I don't get it. What killed him there? Krampus, if you're going after the rule of you have to be festive, that guy was festive. You just broke your own rule. And also, I'm pretty sure there were still a lot of people in that town that were still pretty festive. Although the Myers house is there, and the Amityville house, and the Bueller's house, so maybe it's not all that festive of a town. I don't know. Yeah, I bring up those houses in there because that's just some little things I love about this movie. There are a ton of Easter eggs in this thing, and yeah, it's kind of impossible to find them all, but some of the best ones that I've had point out to me are the houses in this. There are tons of iconic film houses in this movie. Most of that is due, and most of them are just in the regular town. Now, you might be wondering, well, why exactly? Well, it's because the whole entire film was mostly shot on a soundstage, except for all the establishing shots. Those all had to be digitally done. I will say it's actually pretty good CGI, and I do like how they did actually do this all in a set instead of just, like, doing green screen and crap like that. But, yeah, I really do like I do like how they had to digitally make this whole neighborhood, so they decided to have some fun with this, and they decided to throw in a ton of iconic movie houses. Now, the most recognizable one in the town is the Amityville house. The reason why is because it's right next to the main family's home, and yeah, the windows are very recognizable. I recognized them even before having that little Easter egg point out to me. I just only sort of thought at the time that that's what I saw, but I didn't really think that was actually it, but yeah, it actually was. Although I've also heard that the Myers house and the Bueller's house are also in this neighborhood. Now, I haven't been able to find the Bueller's house, mostly because I'm not the biggest fan of Ferris Bueller's Day Off, so I wasn't really looking for that one. But I am a huge fan of Halloween, so I immediately went to looking for the Myers house right when I heard that it was in it. And probably the biggest giveaway of where it is the number of windows on the front of the house. There are 4 windows on that house, however, every single house in the neighborhood, except for maybe the Amityville house, I didn't really count on that one, because that one's obviously not the Myers house. But most of the houses in the neighborhood, they all have at the very least 5 windows, or more, depending, so yeah, that's probably the biggest giveaway. There's one house that's on the very bottom left of the screen in the establishing shot, where there's a house that we don't see the front windows of. However, we do see the side and the back. Those aren't really shown in the original Halloween, so I can't really say that that's the certain house. However, that is the only one that we can actually see the clear color of the house, which is pure white, just like the Myers house was. So I assume that that's their house, since, yeah, the director has confirmed that the Myers house is indeed in this movie, so, yeah, I'm pretty sure that's them. Also, this one kind of ties into the ending a bit, but there's something with a snow globe at the end, and, yeah, there's pretty much this whole big collection of them. And the snow globe right next to a very, very important house for this movie is actually the Bates Motel. Not the iconic house on the hill for Psycho. No. It's the Bates Motel. And I actually do really like that. Although I will say, when people said, hey, the Bates Motel is here, I immediately thought of the iconic house instead of the actual motel. So I went looking for that. But I actually did find where the motel is. And it's actually really cool if you know that it's there. Although, if it's there, that means either some random family in the Bates Motel got killed there because they just weren't festive enough and ripped up a letter to Santa and threw it out their little hotel window. Or that means that Norman Bates is down there. Questions. A lot of questions on that. So I'm going to go with what I'm pretty sure is the main canon for the Psycho movies. Psycho 1, Psycho 2, Psycho 3, and Psycho 4, The Beginning, which is the final installment in the series. In that one, Norman ended up completely sane and actually got married and had a child with somebody. So, yeah, obviously he should end up in hell. I mean, it just makes too much sense. So, yeah, I guess that at one point he lost the Christmas spirit and Krampus came to kill him. I guess that happened while he was visiting his old motel, which he burnt down in Psycho 4, so I don't know how that works. But anyway, yeah, so I'm putting way too much thought into Easter eggs, which are really awesome, and I just really want to talk about the awesome Easter eggs in this. So yeah, back onto the story. So yeah, they're all stuck in their town because, well, there's a big blizzard outside, and they all start getting picked off one by one by Krampus. Eventually they all decide to come up with a plan. They're going to go into this one really big truck that, well, yeah, actually is meant to, you know, get rid of the snow on the sidewalk. I forgot the official name for those, but Yeah, they're gonna go into that, and I'm pretty sure it's a snowplow, actually, now. I just now remembered. Yeah, they decided they're gonna go get into a snowplow and, well, just keep on driving until they find, well, the way out, or anywhere that's normal, or not snowing and in a heavy blizzard. However, doing that is a harder task than they thought, because there are a ton of monsters, pretty much gift monsters, all inside their house, and eventually elves come in, demonic elves. I love this movie. So, yeah, they eventually had to. So, yeah, eventually they do make it out to the snowplow, though, but there's only a few of them remaining. And eventually, one of them just. And eventually, Max, the only one left, as his cousin is just sort of graduated by Krampus. He goes over to Krampus and decides to make a deal with him. Because, yeah, he was supposed to be the one kid that was still a reminder of the holiday spirit, which is essentially what his grandma was. Yeah. Forgot to talk about his grandmother, but she pretty much went through the same thing when she was a kid, except she instead just stayed in her bed and did nothing to save her family. What a nice person. But yeah, she did indeed feel Christmas spirit after that, and well, continued celebrating and believing in it, or else her whole family and town and friends would die again. Yay. Yay. She not get therapy after that. Anyway, so yeah, she eventually sacrificed herself to Krampus in order to save her family like a whole 10 seconds because they were just mostly standing out there and listening to her die. Real way to make her sacrifice count. But yeah, now I'm going to get into a little bit of spoilers here, so I'll put up a little thing that says that it's safe to continue watching at this point, when I'm done with it, but yeah, pretty much I will be getting into spoilers, and this movie is best seen without knowing this part, but I do still want to talk about this. So, yeah, he eventually goes up to Krampus and decides to, well, take his whole family's place, or just to try and undo everything. And Krampus decides, okay. He just throws him into a pit to hell, and he wakes up the next morning completely fine. Is this an Ebenezer Scrooge thing? Nope, when he goes downstairs and goes to open up his presents, they eventually all, the whole family seems nice and happy. A little too happy, though. Although, yeah, that's not too questionable for him. So they all decide to just sit around and open up the presents, and well, then he gets a very big surprise. He gets the bell from Krampus, and everyone just stops and remembers what happened the night before. They never actually survived. They're all still dead and totally in hell now. The Christmassy part of hell. Everyone knows about that part. That's the 10th ring that we never knew about. It's just the Christmas side of hell. So it's a very small part, but it's a really festive one. There's a lot of wreaths everywhere and nice Christmas trees. I mean, they burn up immediately, but still, they make them every year. It's really nice. It's a nice part. So yeah, it turns out that they are instead having to live the rest of their lives, or well, their whole deaths, I guess, in a snow globe of their house. And that's when we pan out to see the Psycho Motel, and all the monsters from the movie jump into the camera, and that's how it ends. And I will say, the ending for this movie is great. Seriously, it's such a dark ending. I love it. I just love how dark they got with this movie that actually does seem like it would have been pretty nice, and yeah, you do get to know these characters and want to see them live by the end, but nope, they're totally rotting away in hell. Yay! Hey. Though at least they still get their Christmas music, so that's nice, I guess. So, yeah. They're just all gonna be stuck together in a snow globe forever. Yay! What a nice ending. Seriously, I love that ending. It is so dark and I just love it. And also, I will. Okay, now we are out of spoilers, but I will also say that another thing that I highly do recommend that you do is stay for the end credits, because there is a lot of awesome songs in this. In particular, the final song. It's pretty much a classic Christmas song, except with a dark Krampus spin on it, and I love it. Seriously, wait for the end credits. Wait through them all. They are all great songs. Seriously, They are really good. Also, if you stay long enough and if you actually care to read some of the end credits, then you'll see that Peter Jackson was an executive producer on this. Yeah. Lord of the Rings and 2005 King Kong, Peter Jackson. I love that as well. You want to know why? Because I'm a fan of Peter Jackson, not just of his Lord of the Rings and King Kong stuff, but also of his older work, his original stuff. And that stuff is so fitting for this. Seriously, if you've seen his older movies, then you know this is the exact type of movie he would get behind. Like, it actually has a very similar feel to something like Bad Taste, Dead Alive, and The Frighteners. And I seriously love seeing that he still is interested in movies like this. I mean, he's not making them anymore, but he still is having interest, and I love that. So, yeah, speaking of fun facts, Seth Green and Justin Roiland are in this as two of the monsters. I don't know which ones, but yeah, they're in this. Oh, and also one thing that I made a little reminder for myself. I should probably have done this, but yeah, again, a little bit in spoilers here, but not that long. I should probably reference the scene Elsewhere's ending with the snow globe thing. Ooh, snow globe! They're all in the snow globe. It's Tommy. He's looking in them. I don't know how to reference this well. But yeah, anyway, so yeah, I got that very important reference out of the way. I'm seriously annoyed that CinemaSins never referenced that. I really would have loved for them to have done that. So I did instead. Anyone who wanted a St. Elsewhere's ending, a St. Elsewhere's reference here, you finally got it. Go around and cheer, I guess. So, yeah, that's pretty much it for this movie, and it's a seriously fun movie. Now, what really makes this film work is the absolute creativity about it. There are so many creative things with this movie that it's hard to even talk about them all. But, yeah, really, they are all just so great. The creative steps that are taken with this are wonderful, and it actually does end up being something rather creepy. Like, the monsters' designs, while I will say aren't as creepy as their original designs, were seriously, look at this concept art. This is really, really awesome. Yeah, seriously, I do kind of wish that the monsters in the final product did look as creepy as they were there. Because, well, yeah, some of them do look very similar to their concept art. Some of them are a little bit creepier there, and I would have liked to have seen those designs used a little bit more. Although, some of them, like Krampus and the Snowman, do look very much like how they do in the film. So, yeah, they aren't that different. It's just, like, I really just like the concept art here. Speaking of the monsters are all practical. Or at the very least, they did all the practical effects that they could for this. Again, something that I love about this movie. It just gives it that sort of 80s feel to it that I just love about it. And yeah, really, I just think that all the monsters in this look amazing, and they really are festive types of monsters. They're not just sort of, like, a little bit festive, like maybe they have a candy cane in their hand or something. No, they're all festive, and I love it. Seriously, they all look great. So, yeah, I really do love the monsters in this. They are beautiful. And speaking of beautiful, well, this whole entire movie really is. I love the way that it's all shot. The use of color, mostly with the use of the color blue and the color of snow just being white. It's very, very well done. I do especially love some contrast at the very end when hell is opened up. It's seriously something that I think is really cool and deserves being talked about, as, yeah, I don't really think that people talk about the color usage in this that much, but it is actually something that's very pretty to look at. As for the humor in this, it's really funny. Yeah, really, I found myself laughing during this movie a whole lot. In particular, some of the sound effects. Some people die, like, okay, let's look at Aunt Dorothy's death. She is sucked away on chain by elves while trying to save a baby. That's actually a really heroic death. What happens when she's sucked away? Phew! It's like a little cartoon sound effect. That had me stopping the movie and just sitting there laughing for like 5 minutes. And then rewinding it so I could laugh some more. Seriously, I love that joke there. And there's actually a whole lot more of them in this. And also, some characters' reactions, in particular Tom, played by Adam Scott. By the way, this was my very first Adam Scott movie, and I have since become a bit of a fan of his. But, yeah. Adam Scott's reactions to some of the monsters here are just downright hilarious, and I just love them. He was easily my favorite character out of this, in part because of his reactions. So yeah, I really did love how this movie ended up being. The story is funny, however, it's also kind of creepy. Like I said, the monster's designs can be actually pretty creepy at times, and while yes, it is a little bit of a shame that this movie was rated PG-13, so yeah, a lot of the deaths don't really get that much of a showcase. They're all usually cut away from, which is a bit of a shame, as I would have liked to have seen some of these people die, in particular Beth. Her death seemed pretty interesting there, and I really wanted to see what happened, but nope, we don't get to, because PG-13 horror. But I will still say that does make sense. The director of the movie did want this to be more of a family film, and yeah, I can see what he's going for here. He kind of wanted a new modern-day version of Gremlins, kind of. Like, it's a horror movie, but it's still pretty festive and does get you in the mood for Christmas and stuff. So, yeah, I can see what he was trying to do here. And yeah, I can definitely see this as a family film. I mean, yeah, okay, there's some swearing and stuff. And yeah, obviously, this isn't something for little kids. But I think that if you have kids that are like, I don't know, 7 or something, then yeah, this is something that you can definitely sit down as a family together and watch, as it's not completely scary. So yeah, it really is something that I do think is very good to sit down with, sit down as a family together and just watch, as it is a really fun movie, and it definitely did get me in the spirit of Christmas. If you're not, Krampus will come to get you. That is if you rip up your letter to Santa and throw it out the window. So just don't do that, in which case then you'll be perfectly fine. Or burn a teddy bear. If you do that as well, then Krampus is coming. But if you don't, then you'll be fine, probably. But yeah, still, I do really like how this movie was executed. It's very funny. It's very creative in the way that it uses Christmas as both something creepy and also something very festive. Its use of color is very, very actually pretty, it's actually pretty at some points, and I will say that the use of contrast at the very end, especially when hell sort of opens up near the ending, it looks downright beautiful in those shots. I seriously love looking at that, because the use of red and orange on that, it just so much contrasted with the pure white and snow of everything around it. It looks beautiful. So yeah, really, I think that this movie is definitely worth a watch if you're in the mood for something kind of creepy that's also Christmas related. This is definitely a great example of one of those, and something that I think that you guys would have a lot of fun with, especially if you're into horror and B-comedy. Well, I guess sort of B-horror movies, as this kind of is one of those, but I think that it fits much more in something with the veins of Shaun of the Dead or something. So yeah, it's really gotten my seal of approval, as I really do like the way the story is executed here. However, you can have a good... So yeah, for the story, I'm going to give it a 9 out of 10, as there are some minor problems with it. Like, again, there are some things that don't really make sense about Krampus and how he decided to kill the whole town, even though, yeah, I mean, Why exactly was the whole town really not completely festive as well? I mean, I get that with Beth's boyfriend, but we don't even see his family, so we don't even know if they were festive or not. So yeah, really, there are some characters that you really do question as to why he would kill this whole town. I mean, it makes sense in the grandmother story, but not as much here. So yeah, there are definitely some things that are a little bit questionable about the story. However, I will say it is an extremely fun ride with a lot of really nice Easter eggs being thrown in here, especially a few that are actually deleted, though they do actually reference the director's other work, which is Trick or Treat. I'm talking a lot about the director in this part. But yeah, really, it's still a super fun movie that always gets a laugh out of me. I really do enjoy it, and yeah, it's definitely something that I will be watching for a few more Christmases to come. But you also still need good characters, so yeah, let's get into them. That there is. No, not yet. For the characters, we got quite a few to talk about, so let's start off with my favorite, Tom, played by Adam Scott, who is easily my favorite character in this. Yes, he's just a really fun character. Now, I've already brought up his reactions to the monsters, which are in part some of my favorite parts with him, as he's hilarious there. Like, he sees this one monster that pretty much comes out with Jack in the Box, and it's pretty much just a really distorted and monstrous version of the clown from a Jack in the Box. And his reaction is, oh, come on. I just love him in this. His reactions just really make this character work. However, he is actually still a pretty interesting character on his own. Pretty much, he is trying to rekindle his relationship with his wife, as, yeah, he's been out on work for a while, and, yeah, that's kind of been just taking away from their relationship for a bit. So, he pretty much is trying to rekindle it while Christmas is going on. And also, he is actually a very nice guy, and I will say he's a very likable character, and honestly, I kind of wish that he lived a little bit longer than he did, because, well, yes, he does live for a really long time in this movie. I will say that, yeah, I did kind of want him to be at the very end, but hey, he is still a very good character, and one that I can easily say was my favorite out of this. So yeah, Tom, he's the best to me in this movie. So, then we got Max, and I will say that he's not the most compelling main character, mostly because, really, I don't think there is any main character, despite him seemingly being it. Yeah, he pretty much does fill in the role of the main character, however, he doesn't really do it completely. Yeah, if that makes any sense. The movie jumps around for who actually is the main character. Like, sometimes it'll be Tom, sometimes it'll be Max, sometimes it'll be Howard. Yeah, it really just focuses in on different characters, so yeah, there's really no main character here. However, Max kind of is it, as he's the one who causes Krampus to come here in the first place. So, he's actually kind of interesting. He has some anger issues, which does add a little bit more to his character, and also, he does sort of seem like, and while, yeah, this sort of thing, he might be a little bit too old to believe in Santa, he still does, and, well, does a whole lot, and he also gets most of his encouragement from his grandma. So, yeah, I will say that he is actually a pretty interesting character when you get down to it. And also, you can tell that he does care about his family, which is a nice trait for him. And he is a good character. It's just, there isn't overly too much with him. Like, he doesn't really develop all that much. It's just that at the end, he accepts his family. Something that he kind of already did. So yeah, there's not all that much development for him, which is a bit of a shame. Then we have Sarah, and she's fun too. Really, her and Tom, I can see why they got together. They are both really fun characters. So Sarah is Tom's wife and Max's mother, and yeah, she's actually really fun in this. She also has some great lines to her as well. However, I can't really think of as many as I can for Tom. And also, you can tell that she's just trying to get through the holidays without having a breakdown. And yeah, that's a little bit harder than it is because, for one, her aunt, who she hasn't talked to for a long time, yeah, she came by. And yeah, she wasn't even supposed to. So, yeah, she's a little bit pissed about that and also off-put by that. So we do actually get to see some more conflict with the family as well as her trying to relate to her sister again and just sort of talk with her. So there are some nice moments with her, and I will say that she is a very good character, and she does have some pretty awesome moments as well. So yeah, Sarah, I do enjoy her as well. Then we have Beth. She's the cliche teenage girl, and yeah, there's really not all that much to her. She mostly just wants to go hang out with her boyfriend, and that leads to her death. Why? Well, I think that she would have died either way, because she decided to go out in the middle of a blizzard to go see her boyfriend so that then they could go get high. Yeah, what a brilliant plan you had there, Beth. I can't just wait until the storm is over. My boyfriend's getting high with a candy cane bong. I gotta go to that right now. Like, what? You're such an idiot, Beth. You're such an idiot. Although I will say she isn't a bad character. And yeah, we do get some nice moments with her. Like, especially at the end, as, yeah, she is pretty much the first person to die. So yeah, we don't really get much with her. But we do see how she has grown a little bit more at the end. And also, we do see that she had a closer relationship with her brother Max, as evidenced by his letter to Santa. So there is some nice things to her that are implied, and she is a pretty decent character. It's just, I feel like she needed more time to be fully fleshed out, which she sadly doesn't get. Then there's also their grandmother and Tom's mom, and she's actually a pretty nice character. Yeah, she's mostly a nice person, although she does have some pretty funny lines, and I will say that she is actually a very likable character, and her past with Krampus does make her kind of interesting, but yeah, she mostly speaks in German, which can be a little bit of a problem. Like, she knows English, she lives in America, she lives with her family, which all speak English. Why are you still speaking German? That's just rude for no reason. And Aunt Dorothy's reaction to it is probably the best way of saying that. But yeah, seriously, why do that when you know the language? What's the point? But yeah, she is still a pretty good character. I don't hate her or anything, and she is very likable in her own way. And yeah, while she doesn't get that much attention until maybe around the middle, I do think that she is still a very good character, and you can tell how much she doesn't want Krampus to revisit the family, especially not her own son. So yeah, you can see that she is a good character. Then we have Aunt Dorothy. She is just pretty much that one person that really sort of hates everything during the holidays, and also, well, she gets drunk a lot, and she also teaches the kids a very important life lesson: how to make peppermint snobs. She's such a great aunt, and yeah, I will say that she's pretty funny in this. Yeah, although sometimes it can be a little bit grating when she's still being sarcastic about everything, when there are freaking people dying, and at this point she knows it. Like, why are you acting like this still? Although you can see there that she does care a whole lot more about the family, as she does also try and go save she does try and go save Linda and Howard's baby, so you can tell that she does care still about her family, and yeah, that is a nice trait for her. It's just, I wish that that was expounded on a little bit more, as there isn't all that much to her. There just isn't all that much with that in the movie, as I would have liked at the very least. Then we have Linda, Sarah's sister, and mother of, well, four children. Wow, she gets around. So yeah, Linda's actually a pretty nice character. We mostly see her caring about her family and her own kids, and you can tell how much she really does care about them, and yeah, that really does make for some pretty nice character with her. There's especially one really sweet scene where she sees all the presents that have been burnt by a fire, and she sees that some of them can still be salvaged, and she still wants to make the Christmas for the kids still pretty nice, and she tries to rewrap them. There are some nice little moments like that with her that I think really do just sort of speak for themselves, and she is just a pretty nice character, and it is nice to see her and Sarah try and bond again, as yeah, you can tell they don't really get together all that much, and yeah, I do still like seeing that. They are nice, and yeah, I do really like Linda's arc, and yeah, she is actually a very likable character, and yeah, I just really enjoy her. She's just a bunch of fun, she's just a really good character, and she does have some awesome moments, in particular when she just decides to fight pretty much all of the monsters in the attic all on her own just because she's really pissed, and I love that. I also do love the fact that despite her kids still totally swearing, she also tries to be a little bit kid friendly around them by saying fudge instead of the F word. So yeah, I do seriously like some moments like that, and she is still a very nice character. And then we have Howard. He's a bit more of a mixed bag, as yeah, he's an alright character, and much like Linda and Aunt Dorothy, you can tell that he does care about his family. However, to a bit of a different way. He's sort of more that character that pretty much is stuck in a different time, and yeah, really, you can tell that a little bit with him. And yeah, he does have some annoying moments, but I will say that he isn't a hateable character, as you definitely also do see some nice emotional moments for him where he truly does care for his family, and despite being seriously injured, he does still want to protect them as much as he can. So yeah, he is still a very good character, and one that I do very much enjoy. And I also love the scene where he fights little gingerbread men, especially since earlier he's the one who called people monsters for stabbing gingerbread men, and now he's burning them, and it's cool with his doggying one of them. I just love that scene. So he does have some great moments too. However, him being injured very early on in the movie does restrict his character a little bit, as yeah, he does sort of have to, well, you know, sort of just lie down a lot, because, yeah, he does have a big bite mark in his leg, so Yeah, that does kind of restrict his character from doing all that much, but he is still a pretty good character, and I don't overly hate him. It's just that there are some moments with him where he can be a bit grating. Then we got Howie Jr., and he's there. That's pretty much most of what I can say about him. Yeah, okay, so Howie Jr., he's essentially mute. Don't know why, but yeah, okay. We don't even know if he's actually mute. He just stands there, looking at people, not saying a word. I assume that he's mute, but they never say that or never even imply it fully. They actually find it weird that he doesn't respond to them, so I'm pretty sure that he's not actually mute, so that just means that he just stands there, staring at people when they ask him questions. Because. So, yeah, that's really weird, and that also does mean that he doesn't get that much character growth, as we don't get that many interactions between him and the family. And he dies by wanting a gingerbread man. Totally worth it, Howie. Totally worth it. So, yeah, he dies by going for a giant chain with a hook at the end because there's a gingerbread man on it. His character likes to eat, if you do not get that. Yeah, he's kind of a boring cliche character who doesn't have that much growth to him, and he's easily one of the worst characters in this. However, I will say the actor does do a pretty decent job with him, and I don't hate him or anything. It's just that, yeah, he doesn't get that much growth, which is a bit of a shame. As for Jorin and Stevie, those two are both sisters, and pretty much their dad really just wanted a son, so they pretty much are very, very tomboy, and yeah, I don't hate them or anything, especially since they can be pretty fun, including, especially, I think Stevie, maybe Jordan, I don't really remember which one is which. They both look very similar, and they both act exactly the same, so, yeah, it's really hard to tell which one's which. Even on IMDb, there's no pictures, I can't tell which one's which, so, yeah, I'm sorry, but one of them, or at the very least the one that doesn't get eaten by one of the monsters around the middle of the movie. Yeah, that one, she does get much more development as we see her interact with Max a whole lot more, which is nice. I do like seeing her get a little bit more character added on to her as, yeah, she was a little bit boring up until that point. However, the other one does not get all that much and is a bit of a shame as, yeah, she pretty much just dies sort of just being the same character that she was in the beginning, so yeah, really, it's a bit of a shame for her, and I would have liked to have seen a little bit more awesome moments with them, because, I mean, these two are both really good wrestlers, they know how to fight. I would have liked to have seen that used a little bit more, instead of just in a scene where they're wrestling at one point, just because, hey, their dad wants to wrestle, so why not? So, yeah, I would have liked to have seen that be used a little bit more, or come back in some way, but unfortunately it doesn't. It is a bit of a shame to me. So, for all the and also, I guess I should bring up the monsters here, in particular Krampus. They are, like I said before, they're extremely fun in this, and I do have a great time watching them. However, there isn't all that much to them, and their motivation is just very, very basic. So, yeah, that's really kind of it with them. But I will say that they are very much engulfed in the holiday, which is really fun about them, and gives them a very, very unique look to them, and I will say that definitely does add a whole lot to their characters, despite there not being all that much. Also, Rick and Oz voice them, so yay! That's cool. Okay, Seth Green and Justin Roiland, but I know Seth Green as Oz from Buffy, and I know Justin Roiland as Rick and Morty on Rick and Morty, and pretty much half of the characters on that show, so I'm calling them by that. Even though they have different names in this, but it doesn't matter. So, yeah, they are pretty fun in this, and yeah, I do really like the design of the monsters, in particular Krampus, who is pretty much just a really distorted, creepy-looking version of Santa, and I just love it. He even wears, like, what looks like a Santa mask, not even like a... It doesn't even look like that's his real face, it just looks like a mask, and I love stuff like that. Like, we don't even really know what he fully looks like, maybe. I mean, that might be a mask, that might be his real face. We don't know, and that's what I love about his character. There's a whole lot of really unique looks to him. So, for the characters overall, I will give them, I think, an 8. maybe an 8.5, as they are, for the most part, they're all very good characters. I do like them all, and I did want to see them all survive. However, there are some of them that aren't as interesting as others, or some that are unfortunately not in it as much. So, yeah, there is a bit of a shame there, as I feel like there are some characters that really could have had their stories expounded on or their characters developed a whole lot more. It's just that they're killed pretty soon before any real development happens with them, in particular Beth. But yeah, it is still, they are still pretty decent characters, and I do really like them. I didn't want to see them die or anything. Tom. Seriously though, his death was awesome. He had a shotgun, he was blasting a monster in the snow. He went out awesomely. Actually, no, you know what? I got my coach jar here. He went out like a badass. So yeah, seriously, Tom was awesome. He's easily my favorite character. And he's also like half of the reason why I decided to watch Little Evil. Surprisingly, also a pretty good movie. So yeah, this movie, so for this movie overall, I really enjoy it. It's a really good recent horror movie, which is something that we don't get often, and this one thankfully does break the mold with a very original idea, a very unique look to its monsters, how engulfed it is in the season, and yeah, that really does make it really stand out. The whole entire look of the movie is very unique, and I will say, it whenever you go outside in the movie, like, whenever the characters go outside in this movie, you feel how cold it is. Everything there is just so beautifully done. It makes it look all so much like you're really trapped in a blizzard. I really do wish I saw this on the big screen, as I think that would have only added on to that experience. And yeah, I am a bit ashamed that I didn't go and see this on the big screen, as yeah, I was into horror movies when this came out, and I still am, so I really do wish that I had. But yeah, the trailer just sort of made it look like a National Lampoon's Christmas Vacation if it was a horror movie, and yeah, that was really my biggest problem with it, especially since the movie Vacation had just been remade recently when this film came out, so I really thought that this was actually going to be a National Lampoon's Christmas Vacation remake. Just a little weird story I have about this movie, but yeah, this is still overall a very fun movie, and one that I highly do recommend you guys check out, as it's a lot of fun. There's a whole lot of Easter eggs in it that are really good. There's unique story here. The characters can be very interesting and very well developed and fun and pretty awesome. And overall, it's a very creepy and good movie to get you into the holiday spirit. However, again, there are a few problems. Like, the villain's motivations and reasoning is kind of weird. And also, yeah, there's some problems here and there. Like, some of the characters aren't all that developed, and yeah, overall, it doesn't really make any sense why they killed all the town, because I'm pretty sure there were still some of them that were pretty festive and stuff. So yeah, there are some problems like that, but those are very easily ignored. And also, there are a few jokes that don't really land, but overall, it's still a very fun movie, and those little flaws can be very easily ignored. So overall, I will give this movie a 9 out of 10, as it is a really fun film, and I highly recommend it if you're into horror movies, if you just want to be into the, or if you just want to get into the Christmas spirit and are alright being a little bit scared. Even though the PG-13 horror does bring it down a bit, as, yeah, you don't fully get to see some of it, and yeah, that is a bit of a shame, but it does tie into what the director's idea was, so it does make some sense. So, yeah, overall, this is a very fun movie, and I highly recommend it. So, yeah, this is just a really good movie. Go watch it if you haven't already. And next week, I will probably be looking at a movie that I've been wanting to look at for a while now, called Noel, or Noel, however you want to pronounce it. It's not the one with the talking, living, Christmas ornament, though. No. It's one with Robin Williams. And, a guy who wants to get into a hospital because of a Christmas party. So he tries to break the bones in his body to get in, despite him just being able to walk in. So yeah, hopefully I can look at that next week. You know, a part of me kind of really wants the Christmas curse to continue and for me to just not be able to look at this because, oh God. So, yeah. Hopefully that'll be what I look at next. Although, yeah, again, Christmas curse might affect me again and, yeah, I might, I don't know, get sick like I was last week, or get really busy like I was the week before that, or just have the power go out like I was again the week before that one. And you guys don't think that there's a Christmas curse. So, yeah. Yeah, that's pretty much it. So, yeah, although if I don't get around to Noel, then yeah, I'll just look at my next, and then I'll just look at, well, then we'll just automatically go into the next theme month, which, yeah, I'll save as a bit of a surprise. So, yeah, that's pretty much it. Bye. Fine, I'll go do something about it.
We will be the death of you!
So, did you guys ever, like, look in a mirror or something?
No, why?
Oh, I don't know, just a thought.